David Juskow's here.
Hello.
I love you.
I love you, too.
You made my night. I'll tell you what you did for me, because I've been very happy lately and thrilled about what's going on in my life and the world. So Alex Brazell has been telling me about...
I don't know who that is.
He's just the guy who is destroying my career.
He's got, single-handedly.
Single-handedly. He's got Showbriz Studios. He's building it on my back.
It's worth it. It's amazing.
It's incredible.
It's beautiful.
He's got Andy Kindler now. He doesn't need me.
What?
He's got J. Elvis Weinstein.
Is that true?
Yeah, and Andy Kindler. They have a new podcast called Thought Spiral, which is hysterical.
I'm sure it is.
And
Kindler's good.
Oh, my God. And J. Elvis Weinstein?
I don't know who he is.
Oh, he Mystery Science Theater, Freaks and Geeks. He's a great writer.
He's a writer. Okay, right.
From Minnesota.
The Joel something was the guy from Mystery Science Theater. Joel Hodgson.
Right.
But that's not him.
No.
He didn't change his name right
then. No, okay. But he did change his name.
Oh.
Unfortunately, he wasn't told you're supposed to change Weinstein.
Right, exactly. That's what I never understood. So I remember that girl from The Love Boat, Lauren Twees. Remember the uh-huh. Julie?
Yeah.
She changed her first name. Instead of that ridiculous last name that nobody could pronounce. I remember that as a kid. I'm like, what the hell's the matter with her? What's the matter with her? She's crazy.
Is that a joke? Is there something like, my name is David Feldman, and yes, I changed it for show business. My real name is Fred Feldman. Is that a joke?
It seems like that way. Yeah, that is really funny.
Okay.
Fred Feldman's funny anyway.
So, by the way, did you grow up in New York?
New Jersey.
New Jersey. There was a Fred Feldman on WOR who was a traffic copter guy.
Oh, he was?
Yeah.
And my mother definitely grew up, you know, watching all that stuff, but I don't remember Fred Feldman.
He was on WOR and we'd be driving and my mother...
WOR, the radio?
On the radio.
Oh, okay.
My mother would be driving me to music lessons. Now let's go to helicopter 74, check in with Fred Feldman. My mother goes, see, you don't need to change your last name.
Well, that's probably why you remember... Because you had that. Yeah. I never would have remembered the child. Uh-huh. I mean, I only listened to Harry Harrison on WABC and yes. All those guys, you know.
Well, I'm going to tell you how... I'm just waking up, by the way.
I understand. So, you're in show business. You get up late. I have a regular job.
And I'm... Let me introduce David Juskow again and why I love you even more than I thought I loved you. You've been doing A Year of the Godfather... at the Cellar, where you bring your friends, comedians,
yeah,
and you do, and this is a compliment, a Mad Magazine version of The Godfather. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, I was nodding my head when he said it. That's interesting, yeah.
I thought...
Of course, I worship Mad Magazine, so
yeah,
it makes sense.
I thought this is a Mad Magazine interpretation of The Godfather, and yeah. You have Jim Norton and Artie Lang and...
Yeah. That's right.
Rachel Feinstein or Feinstein.
It's Stein. It took me a long time to figure that out. That why'd she want it more Jewy? Yeah. That's the way I remember it.
And you get up, do The Godfather, do a couple of scenes. You worked your entire way through The Godfather this year. Kind of like the Torah.
It's exactly like that. Then we're going to start the reading again in October.
So I was in a bad mood.
Finished on some Kostora, we should have.
Yeah. I got a Jew down this show.
Sorry. Yeah, sorry, just, Feldman.
Yeah, I know. So Alex took me to the Cellar. I'll give you another compliment. Patton Oswalt and David Cross used to stage readings of The Day the Clown Cried.
Yes, I remember. And one of them was kind enough to give me the script because I wasn't mm-hmm. in LA when they were doing it. I remember they gave me the script so I could read it.
David Cross, genius.
Genius.
Read the script. He was the narrator, so he would
read.
And
he was doing that 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And he would read it verbatim. He would read the action and treat it as though it were Citizen Kane.
Right.
And then all the comedians would act it out. My God, the first time I said, okay, this is just an event. I'm going to go. I know it's not going to be great, but I'll watch it anyway because it's just, it'll be a goof. I'll leave a half hour in, but at least I can say I saw some of it. I showed up. I think Borat made me laugh harder That's the only thing that made me laugh hard. Then I took some people. They did it again. I took some people. I laughed even harder. Wow. It was even funnier.
Wow.
So Alex told me about The Godfather. You staged The Godfather reading. I knew I was going to love it. I knew I was going to love it.
Because we had spoken before, because if we hadn't spoken before and we didn't, I didn't tell you maybe some of the gags, you might have thought they're going to destroy, you know, what memory I have.
So this is...
It's a risky thing.
This is the thing that I was thinking. And then I'll shut up. I have to stop talking.
Why?
Because
it's your show. This is exactly where you're supposed to talk.
I know, but I, you know, I'm so lonely, and I see you, and I want to talk. I want to talk at you.
So
now, listen, that's a character flaw. I showed up. I cannot see The Godfather anymore. I've been watching it on my Kindle, on a small screen, to the point where it's like watching a home movie. It's just like, it's too, I can't,
right.
It doesn't mean anything to me anymore. Watching your version of The Godfather, this is a terrible thing to say. This is what I thought. This is how mentally ill I am. If I were in hospice, this is what I was thinking. Yeah. If I were in hospice, this is what I would want every day. If I had the money, I would ask you and all the comedians to come in every day and do this. This is how I would want to leave this mortal coil.
Wow.
Just every day looking forward. That's what I was thinking, because I'm mentally ill. You play Marlon Brando.
Yeah.
You sit on the lines. It's like we knew there were certain lines that, you know, we're waiting for, like reads the funny papers.
Right.
When you said reads, and the expression on your face, okay, all right, I'm gonna shut up. But it was just so, it was just great.
Well, you see, you and I know, it's like, I the next day I always go on my podcast and yell at all the comedians that are in the show, because they...
What's the name of your podcast?
The Dave Juskow Podcast. It's very creative.
I have to do it.
I just always, I call out everybody on their horribleness, in the fact that I'm like, how can the men not have, it seems like nobody's seen The Godfather. And you and I know what lines to hit, and Noam, the owner of the cellar, knows exactly what to hit, and you should see him yelling at Natterman when Natterman doesn't get it. But we can let that go, because Natterman's what we used to call a retard. So we let that go. But the other guys, I just don't understand. I really feel like they haven't seen The Godfather, or they are just the worst actors on the planet. I don't know.
And that's
you see, you get why I'm hitting those lines that we're waiting for, you and I.
Right.
And I don't know why. I mean, we work with Natterman. We tell him, we're like, no, you have to pause here, because that's what the people are... It's a very important line in the show that everyone who's here who's actually knows The Godfather is waiting for. He just doesn't understand. It's like if we tell him, he makes it worse. I don't know whether he's doing it to disrespect authority or...
I was so frustrated that I'm not a success watching this. Because Alex...
See, in my mind, you are a success.
Well, yeah. Alex Brazil and I left, and we kept saying, if only I were Lorne Michaels. You know, if I had the power, because I would stage this at the Tribeca Film Festival. I would call up Scorsese. Notice I said Scorsese. I would call Coppola. I would call...
Well, you know, it's funny when they
were... I would do it with Godfather actors.
When they were doing
that... I mean, with Sopranos actors.
Oh, God, that would be funny, too. Do you remember when they were doing the 40-year anniversary last weekend at Radio City? I said to... I was like, we should send them... The show before this, we had come back after a little, like, six-month break. So I had the Star Wars crawl as the Godfather credits, you know, so it said one last scene, the evil Barzini, the evil gangster Barzini has put Michael into hiding in the remote planet of Sicily. And we did it just like that, but the complete, the way they write Empire Strikes Back.
Uh-huh.
And we thought that would be funny. They would probably like that at the Radio City. They would
Let me hear Barzini's a pimp.
Barzini's a pimp.
Right. Remember I played it out.
Barzini's a pimp. But it wasn't until today.
No, it's Tatalia's a pimp. That's what it is.
Oh, that's right.
I mix it up too.
I'm cloudy. I'm cloudy.
Tatalia's a pimp. He never could have outthought Santino.
I'm sorry, I interrupted. Say that again, please.
Okay. Tatalia's a pimp.
I really went for it. Well, I had to exaggerate a little more because I know you're waiting for it. I know only you is waiting for it. I think I said it on my podcast. I'm like, thank God David Feldman was there. I'm not sure who else would get the Clyde Tolson joke. I feel like I only wrote that for you. You can hear you laughing on the tape. I put it on the show. It's clearly you laughing. I knew exactly where you were sitting. So somebody said, who was that guy in the back on the side who was laughing at every... that was David Feldman.
I was in heaven. I wish I didn't have my laugh. Kindler has a sweeter laugh. My laugh is aggressive. It's maniacal.
I laugh like a hyena.
Yeah, I can't. There's certain laughs that I have. My ex-wife had a loud laugh too, and when we thought something was funny,
your ex-wife was Esther Koo. Thank you. Hey-o!
I'm not going to say anything.
I know.
I have something that I'd like to say, but let me weigh how much it would cost. So the God, let's, by the way, I know it's hard to believe David Juskow, but people don't know what we're talking about. So why don't we start from the beginning? Oh. What do you do at the Cellar? You a year of the Godfather. What did I see last week?
It's something I've been planning for a long time. It's just like you were talking about the day the clown cried. We are reading from the script of The Godfather, but I changed the script.
And just a
I
little,
doctor
though.
It, yeah.
Just a little to make...
Right, to add in the
jokes.
Which
makes it so funny.
Yeah, well, we're basically taking all the stuff you and I know about The Godfather and bringing attention to it. Mm-hmm. Like, for instance, the smallest of instances, like when Abe Vigoda's on the phone at the end, like, we're on our way to Brooklyn, and how is it possible that... No, the guy who's on the phone with doesn't know everyone's dead. I know there's no internet or cell phones or anything, but
by the way,
it's the timing that brings in question.
By the way,
yeah,
you referenced something that has been annoying me about The Godfather for centuries. When they send Michael Corleone to kill Sterling Hayden, that Italian restaurant.
How's that Italian food here?
Right. Is it Salazzo?
Salazzo, they try to kill Salazzo and McCluskey.
And McCluskey.
I played McCluskey.
Right.
How's the Italian food? You gotta go, you gotta go.
See, why weren't you at that one? See, I hate you now. I needed you at all of them.
Abe Vigoda knows about the toilet. There's a chain pull down.
We talked about that last time.
Yeah.
And then I think I did a good job. I mean,
who knows about toilet? You have a clip?
I told him about to pull that clip if it...
Let's play a clip.
If you have it.
I've never played a clip.
That's all I do on my show.
Oh.
I play clips all the
time. I've clipped a couple of people on this show. What is this?
I think that's when they said, I'll kill them both. Maybe. Is that what it is? Or?
Hours pass. The laughter continues. There is more laughter after this one line from Michael than when Mazzini beats Wesley in a game of wits in The Princess Bride. There is more laughter from this one line than when Pee-wee Herman asks if there's a basement at the Alamo.
Who's
there is
Aaron?
More laughter from this one line than there is at a Dan Natterman headlining weekend at the Chuckle Hut in Cleveland.
Hey! Hey!
That's Rick Crumb.
What are you going to do? Nice college boy, huh? Didn't want to get mixed up in a family business,
the line
huh?
We were looking for
what
is
what
later.
What are you going to do? You're going to gun down
well,
the captain?
Coming up, right?
Because he slapped you in the
not
face
for a
little
while,
bit.
Because
huh?
Doesn't it... It
no, this is...
It goes
you
when they're eating the Chinese food later, so it's later on.
You get close like this, and bada bing! You blow the brains all over your nice Ivy League suit. Come here!
Sonny, I got this suit at Gimbel's.
Why weren't you
let
there?
Me hear, let me hear this.
You are taking this very personal. Tom, this is business, and this man is taking it very, very personal.
Where does it say that you can't kill a cop?
Come on, Mikey.
Tom, wait a minute. I'm talking about a cop that's mixed up in drugs. I'm talking about a cop. A dishonest cop.
He's so bad.
A crooked
he's
cop
horrible
who got mixed up in the rackets.
It's like Groucho.
And got what he was coming to him. That's a terrific story. And we have newspaper people on the payroll, don't we, Tom? They might like a story like that.
They might.
It's not personal, Sonny. It's strictly business. But if I'm being honest, It's a little personal, too. Oh,
I knew it.
He's Al Pacino now.
He's
playing him like Al.
You say you want to be the CIA?
The horrible Al Pacino.
Oh, let me hear Al Pacino as Michael Corleone in the 70s.
We got people on the payroll.
I'm doing it like Jimmy Gentile. I can't forget it right.
Come on. The newspaper people on the press. Go ahead. Your ink isn't dry on your divorce.
I'm not doing it right.
You're doing it perfectly.
Am I? But that wasn't the scene. That was what we did was he says, sure, I know the place. It's got one of those old-fashioned poke-chained toilets. I really got into the Abe Vigoda character. I did it really well. And then he goes, like, why do you know so much about toilets? And then he goes, I'm going to test you here. I'm going to be like, whatever the place is. Luch House on Second Avenue. Sure, it's got one of those dual flush systems. He goes through all the toilets in the city. Like, why do you know all the toilets? I don't know. I spend a lot of time in the bathroom. It's a gift. Something like that. They go through the whole system. He quizzes them on like three restaurants in the city.
I love you. That's the funniest thing in the world. It's like this flaw in The Godfather that I'm...
Yeah, why does he know all the toilets in the city? Look, Mike.
Sure, I know the place. Good family place. Everyone minds their own business. We might be able to plant the gun. Mike, can you take off the handcuffs?
I think I got Ava Goda down pretty good. Oh. That was the problem, too. I'm the only one that's doing imitations. Everybody else is just doing it straight. So, you know, it's kind of a bummer. Like, I wish... I just wish other people had seen The Godfather. I don't know. It seems like nobody's seen it.
How can...
It drives me insane.
You know what? You know
you
what
have
happened?
The clip?
You know what? You know
wait,
what?
He has the clip.
You and I watched it too much. We drained all the... Go ahead.
Is that reliable?
That's my man in McCluskey's precinct. The police captain's got to be on call 24 hours a day. He signed out at that number between 8 and 10.
24 hours a day? Jeez, no wonder he's so crazy.
Anybody know this joint?
Yeah. Sure I do. It's perfect for us. A small family place, good food, everyone minds his business. It's perfect.
Whoa. Now, wait a minute. How do you know it so well? Since when have you been hanging out in the Bronx?
I hang out in the Bronx sometimes.
When?
Lots of times.
Bullshit. Name a time.
I can't think of one right now.
Oh, you can't think of one right now?
Hey, will you guys knock it off?
I'm keeping my eye on you, Tessio. I don't know what it is about you, but I know something, Detective Fishy. And yes, I said Detective Fishy to acknowledge your television work.
Nobody gets that. Fish.
Pete, they got an old-fashioned toilet. You know, the box and the chain. We might be able to tape the gun behind it.
Yeah, absolutely not. I'm not putting my hand back there. Looks like a box full of water with duty in it. Forget it. And how in God's name are you so familiar with the toilets in a particular restaurant? Why would the name Louis in the Bronx register for you? Oh, yeah, the one with the pool chain toilets. Now, hold on a second. I'm going to test you. Okay, Sardis.
The closed-coupled toilet with a pipe connecting the cistern to the pan is exposed.
Lindy's on 49th
Street. That's a back-to-the-wall toilet where the pipes are discreetly hidden.
Lucha.
That's one of those new water-efficient dual flush systems.
Well, the man knows his toilets.
All right, Mike, listen. You go to a restaurant, you eat, you talk for a while, you relax, you make them relax.
Wait, my God. You, that's an album. First of all, I want to apologize to Dan Natterman.
I finally taught him how to talk into the microphone. It drives me crazy.
That's all right. But you know what? He's right. He's an idiot. He plays Michael Corleone completely wrong, but it works.
I know. It's amazing. And you know what? It's great that you bring that up because when I first was going to use him, what was going to happen, I was going to use him in the first one.
Uh-huh.
And then I was going to play him this one because it was more of a, because Marlon Brando wasn't in this part. So I was going to play him.
Oh, my God.
And then Natterman did such a hilarious job. I just let him go. And he really is terrific when he talks into the mic and you can tell him
Uh-huh.
Like, if we did an album where we could correct him, he would be fantastic.
Yeah, you know what? It's funny.
And I also had him play Ebenezer Scrooge in A Christmas Carol in December.
What's funny about Natterman is be very wary of an idiot, because he plays it like an idiot. And you think he's not getting it. Now I listen to it. I go, oh, he knows exactly what
he's
doing.
Yeah, he knows. No, he knows. He's very intelligent. I mean, yeah. He's very, very bright.
Yeah, he's right for playing it there. Boy, you could make an album of this.
Yeah, it's funny when you hear it back, it sounds like one of those albums we used to grow up on as kids, you know.
Well, I wish I ran show business.
I wish you did too.
Because if I were Lorne Michaels, or who runs show business these days?
Lorne's pretty good. That's okay. Good enough.
I would pick up a phone and demand that you bring in the Sopranos, the original cast from The Godfather, mix up the parts.
I actually called.
Have Jimmy Kahn play Marlon Brando.
Oh my God, can you imagine? I asked Carlo to be in it.
Sopranos versus Goodfellas doing The Godfather. I mean, you could mix it up.
But it's also good with comics, too. Even though they can't act, it drives me crazy. But if I could guide them through it, if we were recording. Well, I guess you want to record in front of a live audience,
sure.
Though, too. So I don't know. But you're right. I get mixed up. Sometimes I want to use actors, but then using comics is fun because they're our friends.
This should be a mainstay of the Tribeca Film Festival. Somebody's got to get this to De Niro and have him do it. It's
Boy,
amazing.
That would be terrific.
It's so funny. It's so well written.
Thank you.
And it's parody. I don't think you're going to get into any trouble.
Yeah, I don't think so either. But I talked to Carlo, the guy who played Giovanni Ribisi. No, that's the different actor, right? But yeah. Whatever that guy who plays Carlo, I asked him to play Sonny in episode 4.
The guy who fingered Sonny.
Yeah, for the Bozzini people.
Yeah.
He said he couldn't do it for legal reasons, and we all just made fun of him. Yeah. And we're like, yeah, okay, all right. And then I heard he was kind of a jerk off. So.
Yeah. By the way, one of the things I've learned is
I used Todd Barry instead.
Oh, my God.
And he was hilarious. And then I'll write the person.
Wait. Todd Barry played
Carlo.
Oh, that's
when he gets
so
beaten up,
funny.
He goes, hey, Sonny, that garbage can's pretty painful. You know? Hey, hey, what's up? I'm Carlo, bitches. You know, I write for the person playing it sometimes.
Oh.
Hey, Connie, shut up, all right?
Well, all right, let me calm down. You're giving me a thumbs up as in calm down, or?
No, it's funny.
It's too funny.
We're having a good time.
It's too funny. I left there. There are a couple of times, you know, laughter, I don't give a shit if the audience feels good. This is all about me.
Yeah.
You know, I'm just like, people are in the audience and they happen to be laughing. That's important to me. Their laughter doesn't make me feel good, but making them laugh makes me feel good.
Right, of course. Every comic's like that.
Laughing the way I did at the Cellar, I walked out of there for like 3 hours. I was buzzing.
It's the best.
It really is. I forgot what it means to laugh that hard.
You know,
Gilbert did it to me at Caroline's.
I remember that too.
Borat, a gold member,
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah, and then I saw Mel Brooks do Blazing Saddles at Radio City Music Hall in September.
What do you mean?
They ran Blazing Saddles while Mel Brooks was there. And they talked about it afterwards.
Oh, afterwards. Oh, wow.
I didn't expect Blazing Saddles to be as funny as it is. I thought it was a moment in time.
Oh, that it holds up.
I was shocked by how it holds up. But beyond holds up. It's funnier
it's beyond
now.
Holds up because now everybody's so PC.
Uh-huh.
It's amazing that they were able to get this through anyway. When you're thinking back then, and that it was like the first of its time where it's the first movie ever where they threw around curse words and just treated them like they were just regular words. And then when you think about it like that, and then you think about how politically incorrect it is and why it totally would hold up today.
Mm-hmm. And it's offending a whole different aisle.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a whole different side of the aisle that it's offending.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's fascinating. Really fascinating.
Is that luck?
I think that's luck.
Really?
Yes. Yes, I do. I think he got lucky in that sense. But I mean, you can never take away the fact that it's a forerunner to every comedy we've ever known as men or young men or, you know, there'd be no Caddyshack without Blazing Saddles or anything like that.
And he knows
that. The one.
He knows that.
I think he knows his place in the world, which makes him kind of, and he should because he's terrific.
Mm-hmm. Have you met him?
No.
John Fugelsang had him on the show.
He did?
Yeah, him and him and Carl Reiner.
Oh my God, can you imagine?
So you had Sarah Silverman.
She actually told me that she went to Mel's house and him and Carl Reiner, they eat together like every day, like just from TV dinners, like trade. They watch TV together and stuff. They're like so cute. They're best friends still.
I'm going to say one bad thing about Carl Reiner and Mel Brooks. They taught me through 2,000-year-old man and Dick Van Dyke, and they taught me what comedy was.
Me too.
However, when I moved to L.A., and I'm not going to trash the Chinese restaurant, they supposedly have Chinese takeout from a Chinese restaurant on Pico. So when we moved to L.A., I insisted that we eat at this Chinese.
Totally understand.
Because it was where Carl Reiner and Mel Brooks.
I would do the same.
The worst Chinese food I have ever had in my life. And
remember, you were in Los Angeles. I mean, I'm not sure what you were expecting there. However, I found that Chinese food is better than everywhere in New York. I can't find a good Chinese place here.
But don't you think Mel Brooks and Carl
They should
Reiner,
eat at a better place?
Maybe
they're affected. They've been in L.A. too long. They're not New Yorkers anymore.
Yeah, or maybe they're operating at such a higher level of Chinese food, I didn't understand the nuance.
Maybe. I mean, you're coming from New York. You're expecting a certain thing with Chinese food. Chinese food's different.
No, I was coming from
Los
San Francisco.
What'd
you say?
Nothing. I called you a derogatory gay term.
They have great Chinese food.
I think they have great Chinese food everywhere. The best Chinese food I've ever had has been in Montreal and London. And quite frankly, Los Angeles was better food than I've had here. I finally found a really good Chinese restaurant here in town on First Avenue and like Delancey, which I think is really good. Which place?
You come in. I can't hear you. Or turn your,
Shanghai
turn
Cafe?
Your
Where's that?
On.
Yeah, why doesn't he turn his microphone on?
He doesn't want to talk.
He's like the worst producer
Hello?
Ever.
Hear me?
Turn your microphone.
You hear me?
Yeah, now turn it off.
He set you up.
Shanghai Cafe.
Where's that?
The best. It's in Chinatown. It's on Mott Street.
Of course it is.
Mott and Canal.
Well, that's the thing. You have to find your place on Mott and Canal where all those Chinese food restaurants are, but they're also a little dirty. This place is clean. It's called Kanji Village. It's excellent Chinese food.
There was a place when I was growing up called New Wador. And I'm not making this up.
You're making it up. There's no name like that.
New Wador. It was a Chinese restaurant. And Jackie Onassis was dating Maurice Templeton.
I don't know who that is.
Maurice Templeton was an ugly, bald financier.
Well, as soon as you until you said financier, I thought you were talking about myself, and I don't remember dating Jackie Onassis.
Short, dumpy, bald.
Again, until you say financier, you son of a...
And I look up with my parents and my mother and father going, it's Jackie Onassis.
Wow.
What's Jackie Onassis doing? And my father points to the bald, dumpy Jew. Of course they're in a Chinese restaurant.
Oh, right, right.
She's dating Maurice Templeton. I think his name was Maurice Templeton.
I don't remember.
Is Templeton a Jewish name?
I don't know. I've never heard of Templeton as a Jewish name.
Well, it has the word temple in it.
Yeah, but I've heard names that should have Judaism in it, but they're not. Like, I can't think of any right now, but...
Chinese food, I've kind of swore off Chinese food.
Really? I still worship it.
I do too, but I can't stop eating it.
Yeah.
So no, then it just...
I know it's that joke, but it is so delicious. I can't stop eating. I can have it every day.
And
I know it's not good for you.
Well, even the vegan Chinese food.
That can't be bad for you, can it?
Yes, because it never satisfies. So I just keep eating it and eating it.
They have this shrimp with broccoli dish at my in my neighborhood that satisfies. That gets me really full. It gets me too full. I can't stop eating it. So, yeah.
This is
can
so
eat a whole quart.
This
quart,
is so quart. This is so embarrassing because Jews
we're two Jews.
I know. I know.
You said you have to stop Jewing
know,
up the podcast.
I know. I know.
Now it's getting worse.
It's worse. And then there's this documentary about Shanghai. You mentioned Shanghai, Alex.
About the actual restaurant or Shanghai, the town?
The town. Because during
was that a city?
During World War II, they took in all the Jews.
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
Well, that's nice.
There's a document. I can't watch it because I know that if I see this documentary, it's all I'll talk about.
I know what you mean. Did you see that 60
Minutes?
Well,
hang on for one second. Let me just tell you. Jerry, hang on. Like I'm complaining about talking too much about being Jewish, and now I want to tell you about the document. They took in all these Jews during World War II, so there was Jew Town in China.
Oh, that's interesting.
Which means every Sunday, the Chinese would say, I'm in the mood for Jew. But there was a little pocket in Shanghai.
I didn't know that.
Of Jews.
Would never have guessed that. You don't suppose that's where the love of... No.
No.
I believe the reason Jews like Chinese food is, from what I've heard, is that it used to be very cheap. And it was easy, you know, it went in like Brooklyn area or something, it used to be very cheap, and it was open on Sundays.
Say cheap and Jew more.
And it was open on
just
Sundays.
Keep saying cheap and Jew.
You know what I'm saying.
More importantly, they don't use cheese.
Oh.
So you can mix dairy and pork without violating.
Well, I mean, aren't you always curious how Jews got connected to Chinese food?
Yes, that's what it was explained to me. Somebody on the show explained that Jews became obsessed with Chinese food. Open on Sunday, inexpensive. You could eat pork with impunity because you don't know what's in there.
Right. Right. And a lot of the stuff has pork in it, but you don't know. Right, right.
Right. Like, and you can
like
order
an egg roll.
Anything on the menu will not have cheese, so you could mix beef. You don't have to worry about dairy.
Yeah. I mean, it is fascinating why, you know, I always wanted to know, and that's what we've heard. Makes sense.
Yeah. But to the point where people talk about Chinese restaurants like it's the Kennedy assassination. You know Calvin Trillin from The New Yorker, right?
I've heard of him. I don't know him.
He's part of this group that follows. If they find a chef, I'm not making this up.
No, I believe you.
Mel Brooks, Joseph Heller used to have Chinese dinner together all the time with a group. They would find a chef, and they would follow him from restaurant to. They would know,
smart,
like a rock star. Calvin Trillin writes for The New Yorker, very fancy, upright member of literati. He and a group followed a Chinese chef down to South Carolina,
wow,
to a strip mall. The guy moved, and they spent a week in South Carolina eating at a strip mall because the chef.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
That's amazing. I could see doing that. Calvin, if I had the money, I would probably follow a chef around if I thought he was amazing.
Calvin Trillin, by the way, is a Jew. But wait.
Oh, I hope so.
Yeah.
Why would you follow a Chinese chef? So, I like Asian cooking, so I would totally follow a chef around. I know people do that with like Morimoto, the Japanese chef or something. They'll go wherever he's going. It still happens.
Is it healthy to be this obsessed with food?
I think so. I mean, everybody's obsessed with food. That's the thing. You just have to try and put it in moderation.
Not like difficult. But now it's gotten to the point where it's obsessive in America and the world. Where?
Yeah, I don't know. It's a good point. I don't think people talked like this back in like the 50s or anything like that, right? I don't know what happened. Now I find myself eating just out of boredom because I have nothing to do, which is why I'm a little dumpy.
I think,
but I'm not even hungry sometimes. You know, I'm just like, I don't have any plans tonight, so I'm going to order something.
That's why I think it's dangerous, especially since we're
older.
Older, yeah. And the country has gotten morbidly obese.
Yeah.
I mean, half the country is fat.
And they blame it on fast food and stuff, but it's not just fast food. Or maybe it is. Maybe it's just so easy to get food and it's so easy to have it delivered. That's got to be half the problem, right? Because people just used to cook. And then they're like, and then you would say, "Eh, I don't feel like cooking, so I won't eat."
Mm-hmm.
But now it's so easy to just call for Domino's and get it in, you know, 20 minutes.
I never did delivery when I lived in L.A.
They didn't have it then, did they?
You could have, yeah, occasionally.
It was very rare when they had somebody. It wasn't like now where you could get every they have a Seamless app or something like that.
Well, but. I mean, there were Chinese and Italian restaurants that delivered, and there were occasionally we would.
treat the kids and order a pizza.
But you're talking around like the 90s and mm-hmm. early 2000s, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember being there then, and I remember the only places that delivered, I don't even know whether China, maybe some Chinese places did, but mostly like that Pig and Whistle, whatever that mm-hmm. place was, that little grocery store would deliver. And that was like, especially late at night.
Pig and Whistle is what Donald Trump calls Rosie O'Donnell's queefs. You stepped on my horrible joke. Rosie O'Donnell's queefs is what Donald Trump called. I'm a horrible human being. Have you ever, this is one of the things that I've noticed you can do in New York, because I've been here for 3 years now.
Just three?
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny. Why'd you move back?
For some work.
Right. Well, I figured. But are you going to stay?
Until those charges are dropped back in LA. So have you done this? I never knew that I could do this. You know, you step outside in Manhattan, it's $20.
Right.
Just you walk out and it's $20.
Yeah.
Have you ever said, you know what? I'm going to stay inside today and I'm going to spend $40 on takeout, but I'm not going to leave the apartment.
I do that every weekend. I do it every weekend.
Where you just don't leave.
I don't leave sometimes from Fridays to Sunday. If I wasn't doing this podcast today, I wouldn't have left my house all weekend.
I have never been like this before, but I have noticed.
It's bad.
It's bad. Is it a Manhattan phenomenon where you just say to yourself, I have nothing on the plate.
Yeah.
I'm not doing anything. I'm just going to read and
it's a really good question, because I wonder what would happen if I lived somewhere else.
Well, you'd go for.
But I think maybe I'm that kind of person, because when I go to LA sometimes and I'm in a hotel, I'll stay there if I have nothing to do. If I'm having a miserable time and I don't have any plans, everybody else has plans, I'll just stay in. I won't even, or maybe there's just no place to walk. I don't know. Fortunately, there's this lady in my building. Sometimes she calls me for a dog walk. It's the only way I get out of the house. But I have totally stayed in the house for a full weekend. If I didn't have a job, I would never leave.
Let me ask you a question. Are you married?
No.
Are you single?
Yes.
Are you in a relationship?
No, I'm totally single, because I think I'd never go out and meet anybody.
So I was at FedEx yesterday. This was really depressing. I don't even know if I should talk about this. Oh, Alex is... I was sending stuff at FedEx, and there was an elderly lady flirting with me. Yeah. And by elderly, I mean probably like 2 years younger than I am.
I hear you. I totally understand.
Bob Saget. I find women my age attractive. And Bob Saget says, well, I'll take you to the morgue. We can just, we can open up a couple of drawers.
Hey, there's a couple of people our age attractive.
Put them on the marble slab. So, no, there was an older woman flirting with me. I mean, literally flirting with me. And she was in a rascal.
What's that?
That's what old people who want attention, they're not really crippled. They just want you to know they're old and they're lazy and they want to gamble and they don't want to walk through the casino. So they ride a rascal.
A rascal. Oh, God. That's not cool.
And she was flirting with me. And there was this little part of me that thought, what the hell? What does that mean?
Well, I don't know what it means. I mean, it's like, if I don't care what happens. Like, there's a woman in my building who's in her 60s, mid-60s, but she looks amazing. And I totally want to go out with her. But she's insane. She thinks she thought she was the running mate for Hillary. But she's really pretty, so it's worth putting up with.
She thought she...
Yes, she with a straight face, she would be like, yeah, I was supposed to be the running mate, and I don't know. You know, I think there's still a chance I'm going to be.
I think, give me her number, I'll call her.
She was in the movie Trading Places.
I'd like to know, I think this is great. She's crazy going into the relationship.
Yeah, completely insane.
So you know what
but
you're
really
getting.
Really hot.
That is, so it's perfect.
Yeah.
No surprises.
Yeah, no, I agree.
Is this sexist? I'm going to say this about both men and women. In the dating pool in Manhattan, which is an island, is it safe to say that it's impossible to meet a good, decent human being in Manhattan? You can meet them in Queens, you can meet them in the Bronx, but on the island of Manhattan, where everything is transactional, people are here for reasons other than love.
That's a really excellent question. Having been single for so long, never been married, been in a few relationships, you know, I'm still trying to date. for me, I know that if I go to New Jersey, mm-hmm. I can meet, I think, more long-lasting relationships there. Plus, I'm kind of a hero there because I have a regular job and I know Sarah Silverman. Here, I have a meaningless job, uh-huh. you know, and I'm just kind of a loser. You know, because there's other people that have more money and there's people that are more, you know, more
and
famous.
And why don't you know Amy Schumer?
Exactly, exactly. So, yeah, so it becomes different. But in New Jersey, yeah, I think I can meet somebody like a more meaningful and, you know, work it out. But
it's
yeah,
the it's skyscrapers.
It is very difficult in Manhattan.
It's the
very
skyscrapers.
Difficult.
Everybody's looking up.
Yeah, that's
so
a good point. Really good
I
point.
Meet,
it's really difficult.
I don't have high standards. A woman looks at me and she goes, third floor. I want to live on the 16th floor. Then she gets the 16th floor and she says, you know what? I could probably get a penthouse.
Yep.
And I'm not saying in terms of money. I'm not saying they're money grubbers.
I know what you're saying.
But some of them are.
Yeah.
They're just thinking, I can do better. I can do better.
I think that with every woman I go out with, I'm sure they're thinking that. You know, because all comedians are like that. We're all, you know.
I'm not like that.
No?
No, I think any woman who loves me, anybody who's stupid enough to love me.
Well, you see what I'm saying? You kind of say, right?
Huh?
Well, that's what I'm saying, too. Any woman that's stupid enough.
Right? See, I did something smart. I moved to San Francisco.
No, I'm not going to do it because that was smart. No, I know you, Marin, Liz Wenstead. I remember at the time that a bunch of you guys all moved to San Francisco and did really well because there were lots of spots out there and stuff. You were able to...
But there was unconditional love. It taught me what unconditional love is. I don't think people in Manhattan, understand what unconditional love is. When I moved to San Francisco, I got married. I had unconditional love. It became conditional, but San Francisco taught me what unconditional love is. You don't have that in Manhattan. People love you on their terms in Manhattan.
That's good.
Don't you think?
I do think. I mean, I don't have that much to compare it to. You know, I've been to LA a lot and spent some time there. And I think it's easier to find women out there, but it's like what you're saying. It's still the same as here in a way with Los Angeles, but I've heard San Francisco is more, yeah, you can find unconditional love there. I believe that.
I don't know if you still can. When I moved there, you could. I think it's changed because of the tech giants. I also think
too.
The thing that I don't think most people understand in Manhattan, that when it comes to love, we're incomplete. If you're looking for a love, it's because you're half a human being. And then once you hook up with somebody, you create something that's different than what you were and what she or he was. It's a whole different thing. You can't go into a relationship with preconceived ideas. You just have to surrender and say, okay, we're going to create something that we don't know. We don't know what this is going to be. It's like a screenplay. Everybody reads the Sid Field screenwriting book.
Right.
And they do, okay, I'm going to do an outline first. This is act one. This is act two. I know exactly how act three is going to be. You can't write. I took all these screenwriting classes, and they always said, you can't start the screenplay till you know how it's going to end. And then, you know, my screenplay sucked because I'd come up with an idea along the way. I got to stick to the ending. And then I met Harlan Ellison. I asked him.
You met Harlan Ellison?
Yeah, he goes, F no. F, you just write. Stephen King, you just write.
Harlan Ellison wrote City on the Edge of Forever, right? That was.
And I think people enter relationships.
That's the greatest.
Like a Sid Field screenwriting book.
That's a good point.
I need to know how act three is going to be.
Boy, that's good. That's a good analogy. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. We all do it.
In Manhattan.
I definitely
in Manhattan.
I don't know. I think people, I think everyone does that. I don't know if that's just a strictly Manhattan thing.
I guess I think about it all the time. Just blow me. We'll see where it goes. Just give me a handy.
Nobody thinks like that.
We'll see what happens.
Especially women, I think. They want to know where it's going, where it's ending, right away.
Maybe this is just a one-act play where you suck me off.
Well, I'm like a girl. Like, I will think right away if I meet somebody, am I going to end up marrying this guy? I mean, I've always been like that. I think like that. Can this work? The first day.
Really?
I absolutely do.
What? Because you're like me. You're lazy.
You think that's all? They think that's a thing of laziness?
I think
I always looked at it as more of hope.
I got it down to a science. Unfortunately, no other woman likes my calculations. I lie on the couch, read, work, eat, sex, exercise, movie, read. Sex, exercise, work, movie, food, sex. It's just there are like five things I need.
Well, that sounds pretty good.
On my terms.
Well, aren't those everybody's terms?
Yeah.
I mean, what are we missing?
Well, I'm greedy with my time. That's the problem.
I think if we were to meet girls, they think they take into consideration we are stuck in our ways, you know? I mean, I certainly am.
Do you call them girls?
Women.
Yeah,
sorry.
That's you. No, because a year ago you were calling them hooers. We have to take a break?
Yeah, we have to take a break.
Okay, we'll be back.